Binayak Sen today is an icon in people's struggles to express their opinions, to stand for the oppressed, to take sides with the Adivasis whose rights are being trampled, to protest, to dare to protest against a police state which kills tribals and calls it encounter. In the name of Naxal Unmolan, it justifies killings, rape, murder, burning of villages, and a displacement. The story of Chhattisgarh today is really a horror story. In the last 3 years, since 2005, when the present government decided to launch the Salwa Jhoom, which they proclaim is a peaceful anti-Naxal movement by the people, but it is actually in effect anything but that. There have been representations and PILs in the Supreme Court, and the NHRC has investigated the issue. Unfortunately, the NHRC, like so many of our public institutions, has really failed to take sides with the people, and its report is a very wishy-washy report. But even that wishy-washy report comments upon several of the things that Binayak Sen and other human rights activists in the area were talking about for so many years, which is that schools and buildings dedicated to education of the children, tribal children, should not be used to house the police. That ordinary civilians should not be armed, arms should not be given to them, to any unaccountable force. That 640 villages which have been raised off the ground in strategic hamleting operation, which is reminiscent of wartime Burma, of Malaysia, of Mizoram so many years ago, that these operations should stop. That Adivasi lands, which are sacred to their people, which are sacred to the memory of their tribe, they should not be given away for a pittance to industries, to large industries, and that these issues of who wants industry, who owns it, who benefits from it, whether the sustainable tribal lifestyles should continue and whether they need to be protected. This morning when I was here, I was listening to our friends speaking about sustainability, about food sovereignty, but what is happening, I mean, Chhattisgarh is really a microcosm for what is happening in the rest of India and possibly what is happening for the rest, in the rest of the third world also. Rampant loot of natural resources, privatization of resources. In Chhattisgarh, we even have a river that has been privatized, that has been sold to a company, and fishing communities, agricultural communities that live on its banks, they have to pay a royalty to the company if they wish to use the waters of that river, which has been flowing through their lands and over which their ancestors had free access. I'm reminded of the speech attributed to Chief Seattle, in which he argues, he is wonderstruck. He says that the great white chief in Washington asks me to sell my land. Is the land mine that I can sell it? Is the air that we breathe, is the river, are all these prairies, are they ours to sell? Is it a commodity? And that is precisely the question today in Chhattisgarh. The reason why Salwa Jhoom has gone on the kind of rampage that it has is because underneath the soil of Bastar, underneath the soil of Bijapur, Dantewada, there lie precious minerals, uranium, coal, iron ore, tin, corundum, and today these so-called backward regions of India, it's important to integrate them, within quotes again, into the world economy, to invite multinationals, and this is exactly where the conflict lies, the roots of the present conflict lie. The issues, of course, are very old. The issues are to do with the impoverishment of the people of the area, the fact that 60 years of independence has completely bypassed them, that in terms of education, in terms of health infrastructure, In terms of food security, the state has provided them nothing. So in this kind of a situation, you really get an explosive mix, and excuse me, people like Binayak, people, other members of PUCL, people like Ajay, who is here with us today, they have taken their lives at risk, and they have gone again and again to document human rights abuses in the area. They have been to Golapalli, where three school teachers were shot in cold blood, and the official press release claimed that these people were caught in a crossfire between Naxals and the CRPF. The reality was that there was a bomb blast in the area, and these three teachers and children who were playing cricket, they ran inside for cover, and seeing them run, the CRPF concluded that they were militants, and in cold blood they pulled them out of the room where they had taken shelter and shot them. Similar incidents are going on all the time, even today. In early January, we began our new year in Chhattisgarh with the Singhavaram incident, in which 19 people, there were triumphant reports first in the newspapers that 19 Naxalites killed in an encounter with the police, and the Chief Minister announced rewards and gallantry medals to the policemen who had participated in this operation. But 3 days later, when the journalists visited the area and they sent us photographs of the people who had died, these were ordinary villagers without a shirt, in lungis, and there were four women, and the forensic report indicated that these four women had been repeatedly raped before they were shot in cold blood. So this is the reality of Chhattisgarh. So if you speak up against this bloody history, if you dare to protest, if you say that at a minimum level, the constitutional safeguards for the Adivasis need to be followed, that any land acquisition in a fifth schedule area needs the consent of the village community, then you're an anti-national. I want to ask you today that when we speak of national security, when we speak of nationalism, what really are we talking about? Because a nation cannot be independent of the people of the nation. National security cannot be independent of human security. In Chhattisgarh, where you have rampant malnutrition, where you have very high maternal mortality rates, where even today so many of our Adivasi children are out of school, in the districts of Dantewada and Bijapur, which are disturbed, schools are practically closed. They have been closed for the last 2 years. Officially, children are promoted every year. But is this what we mean by education? Is this the kind of vision that we had for our country? Binayak is only one person who has paid the price for speaking up. He is implicated in a totally false case. As a member of the People's Union for Civil Liberties, he has been doing prison visits for a long time. Contrary to what the state proclaims, he has visited trade union leaders, he has visited Adivasis who have been put away because of supposedly encroaching on forest land. He has also visited Maoist prisoners. But the fact of his visit to an aged Maoist prisoner has been used to implicate him in the so-called anti-national activity, and today he stands facing trial for sedition, for criminal conspiracy against the nation of India. So this is something that a person who has 25 years of open work, who when he graduated out of CMC Vellore had all the options in the world open to him, he could have gone anywhere in the world and been a rich, propertied doctor, but he chose not to exercise that option. And this is the reward that the state of Chhattisgarh has given him. I know that the people of India, I know that the people of Kerala, the people of Thrissur, the people of any freedom-loving, democratic-minded city, country in the world, they stand with us. And it is only because of your support that we have been enabled to continue this struggle, that we retain our confidence, that we retain our hopes and belief that a better future will come.